Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana. 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 Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana All American Sports Show. Listen to the hottest show that's coming out the south. It's Eric Hatfield and Coach Perry Daniels, man. They're gonna sit you down and tell you all about the game and make it plain. 96.9 FM, that's the station to hear the best sports talk show in the nation. Without hesitation, you should get with this and get your popcorn ready, boy. You better not miss Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana All American Sports Show.
Just so fresh, so clean. Good morning, Baton Rouge. And hey, it's a beautiful day. The birds are chirping and the sun is shining. And you are tuned in to another edition of the Louisiana All-American Sports Show. So hey, this is a look. It's a great Saturday, and of course, it's football season. It's fall. We have a locked, stocked, and packed show for you today. Coach Perry Daniels will be Skyping in any moment from the nation's capital. So hey, let's, as in the words of Mills Lane, let's get it on. So look, last night took us down to the bottom for a District 5-5A contest between the McKinley Panthers and their District 5-5A rivals, the East Ascension Spartans.
Wah wah.
Yeah, it was a wah wah kind of affair because the McKinley Panthers, who were 2-1 in district play, they controlled their own destiny for the district title, and lo and behold, they came out. They were swinging, they were slugging it. They drew first blood on the Spartans, but when it was all said and done, the Spartans came out on top with a 28-7 victory. We'll talk about the game itself in a moment, but right now we have the Louisiana All-American Sports Player of the Game, and that is running back, quarterback, special teams player, receiver.
Yeah, water
Keenan,
boy.
Keenan Dunn, number 7.
First down.
Oh, you know what, Joker? I got caught slipping, man. I didn't have the appropriate. I didn't give the man the appropriate.
Yeah, you gotta give him an applause. You gotta give him a hand clap.
Here we go. Now we got.
Bring him in right.
Our man, Keenan Dunn.
Keenan Dunn, KD. I like that. That's what's up, man.
Has a good ring to it.
Yes, indeed. You never introduced who you are, though. I don't know who you are.
Oh, man. I'm the Phantom of the Opera. No, I'm sorry, folks. I'm Eric Hatfield.
And I'm Gerard Piper, a.k.a. Joker P. And we got Coach.
And I'm Coach Perry Daniels.
And so we got. Go ahead, Coach.
You good, Coach?
Oh, awesome. So look, man, I just didn't know if you guys were aware, man. There is actually, and this is a true story, there's a contest between which city's police department has the most senseless murder of black men.
Wow.
They call it the World Series.
Okay, I got it. It took me a second there. I was.
Tamir, is it Tamir Rice's murder or is it Laquan McDonald's murder?
No, Tamir Rice was Cleveland and Laquan McDonald was Chicago. I got you. It took me a second there. Got you.
Yeah.
Yes, the World Series of police crime.
Well, that's kind of like conspiracy theorists. Me and Coach talked about this here off air before. And, you know, we'll go into that a little bit later. I don't want to get into it now, Coach, and spoil it for you. But it's basically saying that a lot of the killings of unarmed black men in certain cities, that's where the championships has been. So It's kind of sort of like saying that they're letting them get the championships to appease the community.
So wait,
sort of
that,
like
that
Cleveland
means
with Tamir Rice won the NBA championship.
So wait, is there a silver
Chicago
lining?
Chicago is going to win the World Series. There's a lot of killing men in Chicago. You know,
is there a silver lining in this dark cloud? Baton Rouge is going to get a Major League Baseball
right.
team? And, you know,
maybe so.
Man, and I'll tell you, I didn't think, you know, I don't think Ferguson's going to get their own team because they already have the Cardinals, but that could be I can't even.
Yeah, we're just kidding.
Boy, oh boy. You know,
but back to KD.
Sad.
This is, you know.
Yeah, man, we got our man KD, Keenan Dunn, in the building. We just joined Derek Thomas, the man who runs Mission Control. I want to make sure that Perry can still hear us. Perry, say something, anything.
I'm good.
Okay,
yes.
Great. Okay, so look, we had our player of the game, Keenan Dunn, for the East Ascension Spartans.
Yes.
You know, it's interesting. It's the second time we've had a big utility player, and it's the same thing. When you have somebody who can help contribute to multiple facets of the game, that's the one individual who's stepping up and lifting the team, and you did that last night. We saw you make some very good catches in some tight spaces.
Amazing.
We saw you step in the Wildcat. I called it the Wild Gladiator formation.
Right.
We saw you just push the pile sometimes to get to the end zone. Keenan, we chatted a little bit after the game, but tell the audience who might not have heard the post game last night about your game.
We just had to come into the game and win, and I just wanted to help my team
the best I could.
I thought you definitely did an excellent job of that. Joker made a lot of observations too. He was noticing the contribution that you had to your team, Joker.
Most definitely. I noticed actually you was the third quarterback they used. You know, they started out with number 10. What was his name? Wakefield.
Jason Wakefield. That's
Wakefield
right.
Was in the game, and I thought he was doing a good job. But in the second half, you guys have so much of a variety of different type of plays and everything. And I thought when you came in, it wasn't just the Wildcat. He actually threw the ball. So you know, most Wildcats,
right,
it's a direct snap for him to run the ball, but he actually has a good arm on him. Are you officially a quarterback, or what position do you actually play?
I play a bunch of positions. I usually play whatever they want me to play that week, so it just depends.
Now, you're not a senior, right?
I am a senior.
You are a senior. I'm sorry. I got that mixed up. So how long have you been playing football?
Since I was little. I started at a young age, and that's probably why I like it so much.
I hear you, man. With playing all those different, Joker, I'm kind of stealing your thunder a little bit, but why not? It's that kind of a day. You play a lot of different positions, and we often ask some of the athletes on here, was there a player that you kind of looked up to or tried to emulate? But you play so many positions, you know, like a lot of quarterbacks will talk about quarterbacks, but you play all over the field. So do you have a favorite player or somebody you try to model your game after?
One athlete that I do like is Braxton Miller. He played quarterback and receiver, so I like to.
For Ohio State, that's interesting, because usually a lot of young folks will mention a pro player. That's very interesting, and he is a very versatile athlete. And I'll tell you, if your goal is to get to that, you know, get to the college level, major, mid-major, otherwise, his game is one to model one after, especially with a skill set like your own. Coach Perry Daniels was listening very attentively last night. Coach, do you have any questions for young Mr. Dunn?
Absolutely. I believe that what's going on in every high school football player, high school football fan's mind right now is, what has turned around that East Ascension Spartan football team? This isn't the team that stepped on the field at the beginning of the year.
Well, Coach Lee, he continues to trust in us and motivate us each week, and we just want to play hard for him. And we knew we had the talent, we just had to put it all together.
And, you know, Coach, this is an observation I made. I drew this parallel between the East Ascension Spartans and another team that we covered very closely a few years ago, and that was the Southern Lab Kittens. And that, yeah, East Ascension had a 1-6 record coming to that game, but in
right.
those six losses included St. Charles, included Zachary, included Scotlandville, included Santa Maria,
yeah.
included Catholic. And it's not a perfect parallel, because East Ascension is a 5A school, but, you know, Southern Lab, as you remember, they were a single A school. They loaded up with, you know, U High and a couple of other big schools. That's just the one that jumps to mind. And when they got to district play, you know, kind of like when you go to the gym and take on a little more weight than you should be handling, you get really strong when you start to compete on the level. My observation, Perry, and you tell me what you think, is that I thought East Ascension, by the time they got to play district, they played very competitively with the tough district opponents, and with McKinley last night, they looked, and of course they blew Broadmoor away last week, and then they played McKinley and were able to trade blows on the road.
Hey, well, I mean, the young man just said it. The coach believes in them, and they stuck to their process, and it's working out for them. Talk to us about who's next week for the Spartans, and what is going to have to happen for you all to get into the playoffs.
Well, last week we actually beat Dutchtown. That's the team that we had.
Sorry about that.
We blew out. But next week we have Broadmoor, and we're looking to beat them to get into the playoffs.
Wow, so you guys still have an opportunity to get into the playoffs. I was curious to know, I've talked about you as like the third quarterback that they brought in after halftime. Was Wakefield injured, or Shake Snyder, or that, was that part of the game plan coming
Wakefield,
in?
He actually got injured. He was supposed to finish the game, but he did get injured on the last play to half.
Oh.
So our other quarterback had stepped in, but they usually put me in to run the ball or Why not? We need to play.
So you guys adjusted very, very. Now, are you all hosting Broadmoor, or do you go to Broadmoor?
We're hosting Broadmoor for senior night.
So you guys are in a very, very good position right now. And Broadmoor's had a lot of challenges, and you guys have run against the big boys.
Let's just put it out there. Broadmoor is not good. No. Y'all should win that game. You know, hey, you know, I don't hold any punches. I'm not going to cut no punches. The Bucks suck.
So. Oh, woo, that's straight fire. But you all are looking great. So what? So you're so about... You guys are looking, heading to the playoffs. Are you guys in position to host a playoff
game? Let's find this out first. What about the power rankings? Do they know where they are currently Good ranked question. On the LHSAA power rankings?
Usually our coach would tell us on Monday's practice, but hopefully we went up. But we do have the highest strength factor, like rating, mm-hmm. out of Louisiana, so that should play a good role in where we place at.
I believe that. Where were you guys last week, if you recall?
I think we might have been 34, 35. We were right on the edge.
Gotcha. So that strength of schedule is going to help you guys out. So Perry, Coach, what you have any more questions for Mr. Dunn?
Sure, just a couple more.
Sure.
First, let's talk about colleges that have shown interest in you. Have you received any communication from any of the universities?
I was getting a lot of interest from ULM and military schools before the season, and a few coaches like from Southeastern and schools like that have talked to me throughout the season, but right now I'm just focusing on my team and trying to get into the playoffs.
Those are excellent mid-major programs. Southeastern is always very competitive in their league. ULM is always very competitive in their league. Sometimes they beat an Alabama every now and then. So those are very good programs to continue your both your education and your athletic career.
Is football the only sport that you play?
I did run track, but I
believe it.
I stopped running track to focus more on football.
Well, that's what's up, man. Man, you had a nice game last night. I was shocked and I was amazed. But we talked about before the game with the 1-5 record you guys came in with, that don't sleep on this team, because traditionally we know East Ascension to be a great program. And like he mentioned, being able to play teams and even losing like Scotlandville and Zachary and those type of teams got you guys prepared pretty much for the district. Who is your offensive coordinator?
Our offensive coordinator is Coach Mack Kerrigan McCready, and he stepped up. We didn't begin the season with him, but he was our offensive coordinator last year, and him stepping in the middle of the season, we knew the offense, so it was easy to just flip the script.
So he actually came in after in the middle of the season, so he just got there, what, a couple of games ago, a couple of weeks ago?
Yeah, he was still on the coaching staff, he just wasn't the offensive coordinator, but we had to make offensive change because of the losses that we were taking, I guess.
Wow. Well, you can tell, though. He's doing a great job. I love the variety of you guys' offense, the diversity of you guys' offense, the plays you was running. You was using all types of different types of formations.
Yeah, he's a great coach.
Yeah, man. I thought it was very, very impressive. And that was my one knock against McKinley, is that they don't have a variety of plays. You know, they kind of use the same plays over and over. Well, you know, I got a few knocks. Special teams. You guys have a great special team. Number 31. He was supposed to be in the player of the game, too, man. That guy was,
he played good.
Yeah, he played good. And he, man, run back a 90-yard kick, recovered a fumble.
What's last name?
Mitchell, I think.
Mitchell. I want to give him a shot. He played very well. Yeah. If you're listening, good job, young fella.
We all call him Debo there.
Yeah, Debo! Yeah, because he was jacking McKinley's balls last night. Onside kicks, fumbles. That's a good one.
Yeah, bye, Felicia.
Coach.
But, yeah, man.
Well, hey, look. Buckle up. You're in with the crew and you're part of the show. We've got a full show today. We've got to move the clock and push our agenda.
Coach.
So let's.
Yes. Do we want to talk about the game as a whole? I think since we do cover McKinley so closely, I think we should probably maybe just real quick talk about McKinley's performance.
Let's do this. Let's run down the rest of the scores. You know, in high school sports, you know, folks are familiar with what happened last night. McKinley lost 28-7 to the East Ascension Spartans.
Yeah.
So
28 unanswered points.
Yeah, let's run down those other scores, man, so that we could get on to the musical break. We've got a special guest today that we can't show out the listeners.
Absolutely.
On, so
absolutely.
We got to do a little bit.
Sure enough. Okay. So, look, let's go through the scores in the Baton Rouge metropolitan area. Last night, we had, let me scroll down a little bit here. Sorry, Baton Rouge Catholic High School defeated Dutchtown 35-10 last night. We had Central in I'm starting to wonder who's who. Central defeated Zachary 20-19 last night, and I tell you, transitive properties don't necessarily apply in football, but we have seen some very competitive football this year. We've seen some tough teams. Also in the Baton Rouge area, we had Donaldsonville. They put a hurting on Glen Oaks 56-0. Of course, East Ascension defeated McKinley 28-7. East Feliciana 52, Capital 8. We also had last night, Kentwood defeated Ascension Catholic 12-0 as they blanked them in that contest. Also, we had Madison Prep over Episcopal. They triumphed in that contest 33-18.
9-0 Madison Prep. One game left in the regular season for a perfect season record.
It is really incredible what is going on there in that athletic program at on Madison Avenue. Really remarkable in such a short period of time. Northeast defeated Mentorship Academy by the score of 51-8 last night. Plaquemine, oh boy, they put a hurting on Tara, 62-8. That was just brutal. Pointe-Coupee Catholic, 21, Basile, 13. Port Allen defeated Baker in that 6-3A contest, 21-14 last night. Scotlandville over Live Oak, that was in that very, very competitive District 4-5A. Scotlandville got by 28-24. That's it. Go ahead, Coach.
At halftime of the McKinley game, Derek Thomas and I were talking about that game. Live Oak was actually up at halftime 17-14. And I mentioned to Derek that Levi Lewis was not going to allow that to end that way. And sure enough, he scored the final two touchdowns for Scotlandville to win that football game.
That Levi Lewis is a fool. If you're listening, good job, son. He's so fun to watch.
LL
Southern Lab over East Iberville 52. We got to let them know that. Over East Iberville 52-0. Santa Maria over Broadmoor 50-13. St. Michael's defeated Woodlawn 45-31. A lot of points scored there. St. Thomas More over Opelousas 41-6. U High busted out the whooping stick on Brulee 52-26. And even though that's a wide margin, it actually wasn't really that close. I think U High must have called off the dogs in the second half. Varnado over St. Martin's 40-14. Walker, whoo-wee, put a hurting on Denham Springs 70-17. So I'm just wondering what in the world's going on over there. West Feliciana with they defeated Parkview Baptist 21-14. And finally,
wow, Denham Springs. Wait a minute, hold up. Did you say Walker beat Denham Springs 70?
Yes, this is not a typo. You don't have to adjust your sets.
They walked
70
all over
to 17. Walker
but
walked
Denham
over.
Springs, come on, it seems like they started out the year looking like a powerhouse almost.
And they looked awful last week, too. I'm wondering if they had some injuries or something. Coach, did you have a remark on the Yellow Jackets?
Hey, that Walker team is 7-1. Don't sleep on that team.
Well, they're 7-1, and they hung 70 on there. So it definitely is showing last night. So that is the wrap-up in the Baton Rouge metropolitan area. Joker?
Hey, we're glad to have KD here. We're going to keep you here for the rest of the show. We got a segment called I Told You So. So later on the show, if you'd like to stay, we're going to get your picks on a couple of college games, a couple of NFL games. We're going to have a social issue that we talk about every week. But here and right now, we're going to have the song of the day, and actually it's a older song. We usually play a lot of conscious music here on Louisiana All American Sports. So I want you guys to sit back and enjoy this De La Soul featuring Snoop Dogg, and it's called Pain. Check it out.
Oh, I felt like I was running the track. Down the door, race to the studio.
I'm surprised. I didn't know that you didn't ever say anything last night. You know why? Because I think you rolled out early. Yeah, because usually I kind of catch up after I was all done. But yeah, I was still in the air. That's why. So yeah. Oh, man. I feel like I was booking, man. The kids hit me. The twins made my schedule. I usually have a buffer of about a good 10, 15 minutes to spare, and the kids sucked all that buffer up. I was actually finishing it. I told you so in the car on the way to the studio, man. Like, I had the laptop open. I'm still doing edits and red lights and stuff, man. It was that close. Yo,
hey, Coach.
Oh, I think Coach is talking to Derek.
Well. See, pain ain't gonna make it better, right?
Pain gonna make it better. With the raspberry drizzle for sure. Joe, can you tell me something in while that song was playing? Could you share that?
Well, I was announcing that Snoop Dogg and Martha Stewart is going to have a cooking show that's going to be coming on here. So, I know. Have you heard about that, Coach?
No, I haven't.
Oh. Hang on, Coach. We pulled the plug out. It popped you out.
Say it again, Coach. Say it again. Say it with your chest.
Not yet.
Wow. Yeah, you know, I think Martha Stewart really is a cool lady. She may comes off as a home wife, a homemaker, or but I think she's down.
Oh, and she look. I mean, look, she could definitely relate to certain, you know. She's a different. She's a very versatile kind of personality. I will say that much. So hang on, Pam. We're trying to get you. We pulled the jack out. We put it back. It's not putting you through. So give us just a moment, Joker. Keep it going for 1 second, please.
Well, I want to give a shout out first, to my daughter and to the Ravens barbecue. They got a barbecue going on at the Ravens, and those guys have been wanting to tell me to give them a shout out. So I'm gonna give these guys a shout out. Shout out to the Ravens barbecue,
Coach. We should be able to hear you now.
Okay,
great.
Good deal.
There you go.
So you didn't hear my joke about Snoop and
Martha? No, sir. Repeat it.
No, so I was just saying, though, I could see that being a good synergy. You know, somebody who can cook and somebody who often has the munchies. You know?
That goes together, right?
Oh, yeah.
Make those cookies.
So hold on, man. I got to remember we've got our young athlete in there. We got to make sure we're appropriate. All right. Let's move on.
All right. Coach, fire away.
Yeah.
The floor is yours, Coach.
All right, so let's move on to the Bluff, man. This is a huge game for Southern today, traveling up to Alcorn to take on the Alcorn State Braves, and they haven't beaten this team in the last five tries, but, you know, hey, this isn't the same Southern team. Lenard Tillery, the McKinley High grad,
yes,
is 114 yards away from setting the all-time SWAC career rushing record.
Wow. You said SWAC or Southern?
SWAC.
SWAC. Think about that.
Wow, that's big.
Think about all the guys, Walter Payton. Right. All the guys who've come through Walter Payton and all those great athletes, you know, from the 70s and 60s and 50s, and these Hall of Famers. I mean, you know, that's incredible, Coach. I mean, you know, he's a 4-year starter. I know. Do you have the actual record in front of you by any chance? The number?
I do not.
Okay.
I do not.
Well, Coach,
he's 114 yards away. Willie Quinn's about 150 yards away from setting the all-time Southern University receiving record.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. Coach.
Terry.
Question: does Lenard get a NFL shot?
He definitely should. I would think, no doubt, that someone would give him some type of opportunity. This kid walked on to Southern. No one recruited him out of high school, out of McKinley. He walked on at Southern.
That's a lot, of intestinal fortitude shown by that young man. And yes, Mission Control, we got you. That's a lot of intestinal fortitude shown by that young man. And I'm going to tell you what, I think even though he's at a smaller school, at a mid-major, like you said, he is the all-time record holder in SWAC, and NFL teams need running backs. And we've seen rookie free agents come in and become contributors, and even a couple become stars in the NFL. And not only that, but regrettably, running backs in the NFL get hurt left and right. So I think he will be on a training camp roster, and an opportunity could come knocking for Leonard Tillery. Yeah. I'm hopeful. I'll keep my eye on him for sure.
Well, definitely Fournette should be the number one guy coming out this year. So
he'll be the first running back for sure. Probably number one. Probably
number one. Number one pick, I would think.
Southern University, though, I'm having so much fun watching this team. And you know, I said they were going to clobber APB last week, and they pulled out the stick. Coach Odoms had to call the dogs off on them.
Principality.
It was the principality, man. I'm gonna tell you, I don't have it ready. It's the principality, but I am loving what they're doing. This is a real test. They're going to play an Alcorn State team that is very consistent, that is very hard to beat at home. When that Braves crowd gets going, and especially you have a major rival, a good competitive school like Southern, that crowd can be prohibitive. I don't know what's in the air there in Mississippi, but it's going to be tough. And boy, oh boy. I want Southern to win this game.
I know you want them to win, so what are you saying? Who are you picking?
I'm picking the Braves, I'm hoping that Southern can prove me wrong and buck the trend. And I think they have as good a chance to do it this year as they have in any of the previous five.
I'm going with Southern.
Hey, so before Joker makes his pick, man, Eric, you talked about you don't know what's in the air there in Mississippi. Well, I know someone who does know what's in the air in Mississippi.
And
he's a Mississippi native. He's new to the Louisiana All American Sports team, and he's calling in live from Alcorn, Mississippi, right now.
Okay.
That is Mission Control, Derek Thomas. Derek, talk to us about the weather there, the atmosphere there in Alcorn, Mississippi.
Well, the weather is beautiful. It's nice and cool, got a nice breeze. So I don't know what Eric is talking about going to be in the air, but I just think Southern going to run through Alcorn.
Really?
Really. Hey, right. Now, you my man, see. You my man. You know, you're okay with me, Derek.
Of Tillery's record, there's a discrepancy between Southern's records and the NCAA's records because of some, incorrect stats.
Mm-hmm.
So, actually, you know, the NCAA has him with one set of yardage, and Southern has him with another amount of yardage. But the Southern University records, as far as my research is concerned, is correct, and the NCAA needs to update their records for his yardage.
Derek, I'm glad you brought that up. I have a question. I thought I had read that Willie Quinn actually broke the Southern University record like a week or two ago, and there was something with the stat sheet. I read that in the newspaper. Can you shed some light on that? Or maybe the air I'm breathing is scrambling my brain cells, but could you shed some light on that, please?
What was that?
I was saying, I thought I'd read a week or two ago that Willie Quinn had already broken the Southern University record for receptions. Could you shed some light on that deal with the stats? Is what I'm saying.
Right. Quinn actually should have the record also, so hopefully the NCAA will update their record books so that these young men can receive their accomplishments and have them correct in the annual.
That's what I thought.
Southern and the NCAA.
So, but for the record, you are in Southern's corner. So, for next week's I Told You So, you're picking Southern, right, Derek?
Eric,
I'm picking Southern to win this game.
Okay. What about you, Joe?
I'm picking Southern. I'm going with the momentum. I think Southern has been on a roll. And, you know, Alcorn, of course, is a big rivalry. And we usually were born with the air offense that those guys have, but I'm going with Southern to pull this game off. I would come with a score, but you know, Southern wins.
Coach,
our play of the week,
Keenan,
Southern,
my man.
Coach,
hey, SU all the way, baby.
Wow.
Hey guys,
so I'm sitting.
I hear our special guest is calling on the studio
line.
Sir.
Oh
mm-hmm.
Yeah,
he's here.
I think we have him online already.
Oh yeah. How y'all doing, Milton Mack?
What's going on, Milton Mack?
Oh, everything's all right.
It's all good.
Y'all picking. I heard y'all picking SU now. Hold up, now them braids ain't nothing nice now.
All right.
And we got Mac now down there. You know, he's doing his first year, doing a good job.
Okay.
I dig Alcorn.
Alcorn. Okay.
I'm not alone.
Oh, yeah.
I thought I was sitting by myself, the only one with a tomahawk in my hand up in here. So, look.
Oh, yeah. You got an alternate in the house, man.
Man, so former New Orleans Saints defensive back Milton Mack. Actually, I watched you growing up. I remember your career pretty well. That was right in my wheelhouse of when I started really watching football seriously. And it's great. Thank you for joining us today. It really is a treat to have you on the show today.
Yes, most definitely.
Hey, I'm honored. I'm happy to be here. No problem.
So I guess we'll lead in. I'll let somebody. Derek, you hooked it up, so you get the first question, bud.
All right. So Milton. You know, you were just enshrined in our high school's Hall of Fame, and also Alcorn's Hall of Fame. So why don't you tell us, what does it feel like to receive the honors of your recognition of your career?
Well, it makes me feel real good about that, and also makes me feel that the work that I put in to get to where I have gotten, it was well received. You know, it feels like the work I put in means something, you know what I'm saying? And for my friends and my peers to, you know, to congratulate me and to be there, it's just a great honor, man.
Milton, you know, you have a very, of course, we're the Louisiana All American Sports Show, and you have a Louisiana connection. Talk about your time in New Orleans, because we have a lot of diehard Saints fans, myself included, that listen to the show.
Oh, yeah, hey, New Orleans was time of my life. You know, coming out from Alcorn State University and being drafted by the New Orleans Saints in the fifth round, I mean, it was something special to me. But when I got there, it was all business. You know, I didn't realize that, that it was just such a business to where, really the NFL stand for not so long. Mm-hmm. So it was found out how hard it was. That's something that was very hard to do. You know, I like to tell the kids that's out there right now, it's nothing easy. You'll have to really prepare yourself, and you should also have a second thing that you would do, you know what I'm saying, like after football. But the overall, I love New Orleans. We gave them their first win in season. We gave them their first playoff game, and, I'm just happy that I was, a part of that.
Milton, you mentioned something very important. It was something that's been on my mind all week since I knew you were going to come on the show. You mentioned how the NFL is a business and how it is hard. And you came into the NFL, you came with the Saints, you were with the Saints during that 1987 season, and yes, it was a special year, made the playoffs 12-3 year, but also you saw that business side of the NFL as they had the player strike, and if I remember correctly, I was 12 at the time, that was a long time ago, but if I remember correctly, you played through the replacement games, is that correct?
No, actually, I went on strike. Mm-hmm. I didn't cross until everything was basically done. I think it was like that, we had like three games where we didn't play. I think I played that last
that
game.
That Bears game.
Chicago Bears.
You had a game-winning interception. But I remember that.
Exactly. Yes, I did. And that was a turning point in it. You know, I didn't cross the line. It was just the fact that everybody was coming in. So me being a rookie, I just wanted to get back in and go to work. That was my whole plan. It's just fact. I did participate in the strike,
mm-hmm.
but at the time it was back to business once it's all cleared up.
Talk about that business side, how it was for you back in the 80s and how you see it today. You saw there was a big dispute a few years ago and how the business side is really, the business side is real. And I'll turn it over to Joker after that, but I had that on my mind all week. If you could just talk about that, comparing your time to today with the business side.
Today, we wasn't making that much money as they make now. You know, there's so much money involved with it, and the business have changed, but it has changed to where, you have social media now, and it's a lot of things that player can do that really can hit the media real fast than when I was playing. We didn't have that, we barely had the cell phone. I think I was the first guy that, to get a cell phone in my little town, man, But anyway, things have evolved like that, and, so we have to make adjustments. Athletes have to make adjustments. I mean, it's a business. It's a lot of money that can be made, and you have to have the right representation. And just keep your head on right. But like I say, it takes a village to raise a child. When I went That's to the right. pros, I had Alcorn, behind me. I had Callaway High School behind me. I had my family. So it really takes a lot of people to, you know, to get that one guy, that guy that is the key to the lock, you know what I'm saying? Because it's a local. There's so many people, other players that tried to play this game and couldn't do it. So the ones that are able to do it, there are some special. And people who have family like that, family members like that, rally around them to make them so that they can become the best that they could be, possibly be, you know?
Well, this is Gerard Piper, a.k.a. Joker P, and I just want to thank you again for joining our show. But I have a two-part question. We usually talk about a social issue. We have a young man in here, which was our player of the game. His name is Keenan Dunn. I want you to give him some words of advice. He's in high school. He's a great high school player, and I know he has aspirations of going to the next level. I want you to give him some advice on the hard work and dedication, sort of piggyback on what you was just talking about first.
No doubt. It's about applying yourself. See, a lot of, you know, you got to think of yourself as, like you said, they call you an athlete, okay? So you are something special out there. You have to be able to go out and play a football game, and you might sprain your ankle or something, then you have to go back and go to class. But I'm telling you now, education is the number one thing. Right. You should try to, you know, get a scholarship, but you should try to go and finish school first. You know, football is something extra. It's not given to everybody. Mm-hmm. But you can use that to get an education and can be some positive in your life. Take football and the education that it gives you and become something very special. But it's hard work. When I played in the league, I ran 2 miles every morning. That was just part of it. And then every day I did something like 30 minutes on all my footwork, all my drills. You know what I'm saying? This is something that you have to work very hard at. It's not given. You know, nobody give away no money. So you have to work extremely hard to get to that level.
Right. Well, thanks for that. My second part was, of course, now we've seen a lot of with the protests of National Anthem of unarmed black men getting killed. And I wanted to know your take on Colin Kaepernick's stance and what's going on now socially in the NFL.
Well, I was watching TV this morning, and I heard him get a good call on that because they wanted to interview him. Now, I stand for what he believes in because, you know, I mean, it's enough. It's just enough. It's enough of things going on. Police brutality, it's enough of it. It's been going on. I'm glad that he's standing up for it. I'm with him on that. But I doesn't oppose national. It has nothing to do with the national anthem. Just a statement we want to make. Why are we standing up with the national anthem when some of our black people have been killed for no reason? So I'm part of that. I think that's a big. It takes people of our status, athletes, stand up for our rights and what we believe in. You know, it's impossible until done, like Nelson Mandela said.
All right. That gives everyone hope and opportunity. Keenan, do you have a question for Mr. Mack?
Kind of caught him off guard on the spot. Take a second to ask him anything.
I'll get mine in, and while he's answering mine, you think of yours, because we want to give you that opportunity, being the Louisiana All American Sports Player of the Week. So I want to find out about the current state of the Saints, and what does he think about that Swiss cheese secondary that we have down there. And what do the Saints need to do to improve?
All right. Are there a question for me?
Yes.
The Saints, hey man, listen, you know, they have a tremendous offense. And as we can see, you know, Drew Brees is legendary. You know, he's probably the Hall of Famer, one of the great quarterbacks to ever play for the Saints. But the defense needs work. You know what I'm saying? We have a lot of young guys in the secondary, a lot of guys banged up. So, you know, that calls the team not to play right when you don't have the players that you want to have in there. You know, football is a physical game. You know, we get injured from week to week. And that's why you should have a team of players. When we have 53 people, so we can, you know, it's going to be some injuries. But the Saints are looking up a little bit. You know, if we can just tighten up that defense, get some people back from injury, we'll be okay.
All right, Keenan, you ready?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm ready. I know you probably had some ups and downs throughout your career, and I want to know what helped you stay focused and and stay prepared through all your ups and downs? Like, how did you deal with them?
Right, right. Well, you know, me playing, you know, this cornerback position, I mean, you could be beat in a minute. And I always had that poker face mentality. No matter what, I never got too high, I never got too low.
Yeah.
That's some of the things that you take with me. But I want to tell you a little story, man. If someone put a battery pack in my back years ago, you know, I really hadn't told a lot of people this, but my mother died when I was 13 years old, Miss Annette Mack. And she was a beautiful person, beautiful thing to me. And at the time when she left, I was 13 years old, so, you know, my plan, so whatever I did, and I had a battery pack, so I wanted to be the best.
Mm-hmm.
And I refused to lose. See, Milton Mack, I was scared of failure. That was fueled in me. But I always learned how to take things in stride. My grandparents taught me to always keep chopping wood. Mm. You know, I'm a country boy from Jackson, Mississippi, and that's what I did, man. And that's how I made it. But I put God first. Got to put God first.
Always.
You know, Milton, you mentioned that, you know, having that chopping wood mentality, and definitely there was one special guest who just jumped in on the hotline when he heard you were on the show that you knew probably very, very well. And
playoffs? What are you talking about? Playoffs?
What was it like to play for that man?
Oh, man. You know what? At the time, you know, I really didn't like him. I mean, he was a military type guy. I mean, we could be coming to meetings now. We be coming to everybody on time, but he see you coming down the hallway. We got 10 minutes. I mean, Jim Moore would start hollering, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, you know, just to get us in there. And if you're late, now he will find you, you know, and the money went to good cause. But that's the type of guy he was. He was a military-type guy. He taught me a lot about being disciplined
mm-hmm.
in football. That's very important. He had us men, and we were very disciplined, and we wanted to win.
And Mr. Mack, you have one other connection to Saints coaching. I'll say this again. I was 12 at the time, but if I remember, that game-winning interception I mentioned earlier, that was thrown by Mr. Sean Payton, wasn't it?
That's right. Well, you know, I was talking to some people. I think it was last week. Matter of fact, you know, my Hall of Fame people from Callaway, and one of them asked me about that game, and they said, you know, that the quarterback was Sean Payton. I said, yeah, that was Sean Payton. Yeah, I did intercept him in the game back in 1987 with
Chicago
Bears. Wow. That's so cool. Hey, man, so we want to get your opinion. We've got to pick some other games and move on with the show.
Oh, there y'all go, man. There y'all go. Okay.
Thank you for joining us today on Louisiana All American Sports. We want to get your perspective. We have a segment we called I Told You So that should be coming up just shortly mm-hmm. here.
It's ready to whenever you're ready.
All right, so let's get his picks. No, let's let him hear the I Told You So, and then we'll get his picks.
All right, this is what you're up against, Mr. Mack. Here we go. It's our usual segment, I Told You So.
I told you. What did I tell you? Didn't I tell you? Because I told you. Mm-hmm. And when did I tell you? A long time ago. And what did I say will happen when I told you? Exactly what just happened.
Radio inside your house, so you can't catch the action either
way. And I was frustrated last week, too, because I was saying to myself, Southern is better than what they was playing. It was keeping Jackson State in the game.
They were helping them. It was like
helping them. So, I'm picking Southern to win today.
Yeah, I'm picking the Jaguars also. I think they ought to actually. Arkansas Pine Bluff has got a lot of problems. They're, I think, 1-3 or 1-4 in SWAC play. That program is just they're 1-3 in SWAC play, 1-5 overall. But Arkansas Pine Bluff the last couple of years has been very much in the doldrums. I expect Southern to clobber APB, especially with it being homecoming. They're going to be charged up today.
Hey, well, I'm not sure if a clobber is going to happen. I do pick the Jags to win.
5% chance to win. I know LSU's favored by like about 4 points in Vegas. I'm gonna pick LSU. Obviously, that's my team. I'm not gonna pick against them when I don't have cause to pick against them. But what I'll say is, don't be fooled by Ole Miss's record. This is a team that has lost some big leads against some very good teams in some close games. So I think it's gonna be tight. I think it's gonna be less than a 4 point. I think it's gonna be the last team to get the ball wins. But I expect Fournette to have a big game.
I think with Leonard Fournette coming back, joining the way the offense has been, it's not been too bad. They haven't been giving the ball up.
They've scored.
Yeah, they scored and they put points on the board. And so I'm going to lean a little bit toward LSU just because of the home field advantage. So I'm going with LSU Tigers to beat Ole Miss.
I'm going to go with Ole Miss here. I do have to give big props.
I think they're going to have to score a lot of points to beat Texas A&M, but I do think Nick Saban and Alabama in Tuscaloosa, Crimson Tide.
I got my incense set up over here. I got my music. Let me turn the lights down a
little bit. Nick Saban, you're the best.
Nick Saban, you're the best. Nick Saban, I'm sorry. I won't take it. Nick Saban, you're the
We like to have fun here.
So, you know already, Joker P is not going against Nick Saban. I will be picking Nick Saban and the Alabama Crimson Tide to defeat Texas A&M.
So, normally, you know, hey, I'm on the bandwagon. I'm following Joker with this. However.
Oh, no.
I'm going to pick, going with the Chiefs.
I'm going to have to go with the Chiefs on this. I can't go with the Saints on this. I'm going to go with the Chiefs. Kansas City Chiefs win this game. I'm going to even give a score of 28-17.
Wow, that's pretty good. I'm going to go with the Chiefs here as well. I know we've got one more.
I think New England will win the game, but I'll tell you what, I'm not as cocksure as a lot of folks might be. That's going to be a 325 game on CBS tomorrow. But Pittsburgh...
Eric, I'll give you 10 points in that game.
Really?
New England's going to beat those boys by...
It's going to be a very, very close football game. Although I do think that New England will pull it out. Now, the love story. So last week, I go to the movie.
Coach, I hope I didn't drop the ball on something when
I told you.
Yeah,
he dropped the ball.
Did you pick Alabama last week.
No, he didn't pick Alabama. He started out saying he was going to, and then
Thank you, Eric. I appreciate that. Let's get Milton Mack's pick on this week's game. The first one up is the Nebraska-Wisconsin game.
Wow.
Who do you have?
I got Wisconsin. I think
The reason why we chose that game in that game, not only is Nebraska 7-0, but Michael Rose Ivy, Deshaun Neal, and Muhammad Berry, all Nebraska defensive players, decided to take a knee in solidarity with Colin Kaepernick, and they have received death threats all week from folks in Nebraska. Mm. So let's go around the horn. Let's start with Derek Thomas on the line. Derek, who would you choose in that game?
Derek,
you still with us?
I hear crickets.
Air traffic.
What about him?
Who you got, Eric?
I'm going to take, look, in the football game, I'm going to take Wisconsin, but I definitely, my spirits are with the intentions and the right to express themselves, those Nebraska players, and I do wish them Godspeed.
I'm going to step out on a limb and choose Nebraska Cornhuskers. I'm going to go with those guys. I'm going to go with Nebraska.
And our player of the week?
I got Nebraska.
Right on.
All right.
I'm going to take Wisconsin here. I think that's a really good football team that beat LSU the first game of it. The next game is between Dallas. We're moving to the NFL now, Milton.
Okay.
This is between the Cowboys and the Philadelphia Eagles.
Oh, I like Dak Prescott as a player, and I think the offensive line for Dallas is the best line in the league. Philadelphia, they do have a rookie quarterback. I think he has some bumps in the road right now. I take the Cowboys.
I guess I'll go next. I like the Dak attack, too. I've been very impressed with Carson Wentz, but I do think the defenses are starting to catch up to him, and I think Dak has a better supporting cast around him than Wentz does. For that reason, I'm going to go with the Dak attack and the Dallas Cowboys.
I second that, Eric. I'm right there with you. I think Carson Wentz is really a great quarterback. I think, and plus Dak Prescott, of course, being a Louisiana native, I got to go with Dak. So I'm going to go with the Cowboys, Ezekiel Elliott. Hey, The boys is on the roll, so Cowboys all the way.
Dak and Zeke.
He's got the Cowboys.
Zeke,
Coach, I know your dad's listening, so.
Very good point, Eric. My dad's a huge Dallas Cowboy fan, and I'm going to make him proud today and pick the Cowboys as well. Hey, Milton, who do you have as the quarterback of the Dallas Cowboys once Tony Romo returns?
Wow.
Since you've been in NFL locker room before, talk to us about that. And what decision would you make?
What decision on who gives them the best chance to win? And we also have to look at that football is a young man's sport. You know, but we do understand Romo has a lot of ability, a lot of knowledge in Dak. But Dak is the player for that position right now. So he's a young cat. He's hungry. And by the way, he played in a pro offense coming out of Mississippi State. And a lot of people don't realize that. And I think he'll do well. I mean, I would go with, Dak. Understand, they have a lot of money invested in Romo. They have a lot of money invested. But, yeah, you know, the players want to win right now. It's hard to win in the NFL. And if he's giving you a better chance of winning,
of course.
Better chance of new lights, waking up the Cowboys, everybody excited about him. That's who I would go with.
I'm not the owner,
but I would go with Dak.
Mr. Mack, let me ask you a question. Do you think a situation like what happened with the Broncos last year where Gary Kubiak, you know, Peyton Manning had re-injured himself even though he was still on the roster, and he put the young guy in and Osweiler got on a roll, and then when Osweiler's inexperience started to catch up with him, that was when he put Manning back. Do you see a similar situation possibly happening with the Dallas Cowboys?
I don't see
that. Exactly. It could. I mean, if it gets to that point, I mean, they have no other choice but to do that.
Yeah, I think
you know
that.
Yeah.
Well, I think that just the momentum of what Dak Prescott doing, and you know, my brother lives out in Dallas, so I get a lot of news from him and what the people are saying and what the local news is saying. And from my understanding, they put Tony Romo back in the star position. The town is going to go crazy. The town is all behind Dak Prescott, you know, and Tony Romo can be a backup. You know, you will have a great backup. You got a guy that you're paying a lot of money to, but, you know, he can be the second string. If Dak goes down, you always had an option to put Tony Romo in there. But to mess up that type of chemistry with the with a rookie running back, because not only is a rookie quarterback, it's a rookie running back. And so I think Ezekiel and Dak also have a camaraderie that they've been playing together. And so Tony Romo don't have that with Ezekiel Elliott. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's just common to me. The way that they're rolling right now in the momentum, 5-1, and if they win and beat Philadelphia.
And that's huge.
In first place, be 6-1, they'd be Green Bay on the road, they didn't beat some tough teams. And so I think Dak has proven himself. Osweiler, that was kind of a little different where Peyton Manning, of course, was struggling before he got injured. He still was struggling, and their defense was so good. It was kind of just, you just needed a game manager. But Dak, man, Dak attack, Dak for president.
He's only threw one pick.
So, real quick, we've got to get his pick on the Seattle Seahawks and the New Orleans Saints.
Oh, man. Oh. Do we have to pick that up?
Do we have to pick that? Man, I love my Saints, man. I love my Saints. Now, y'all got me twisted. I love New Orleans, but, I'm a football fanatic. I watch it all the time. I think Seattle will be a little bit too much for the Saints right now. Because, they're playing good right now. Defense and, Russell, he's moving around well with the offense back. You know, his knee back started a little bit. So, I look for them. I look for Seattle over the Saints.
I look for Seattle. Okay.
Look, I sold my tickets to Sunday's game, so you know I don't expect the Saints to win this one. And then Seattle's coming off of that tie on Sunday Night Football. They're not going to just score 6 points against that defense. So, yeah, I through gritted teeth, I'm picking the Seahawks.
Wow. You know, of course, the way it looks is like Seattle's just going to come in there and do what they do. And I've only picked the Saints, I think, once this year. I was right on that one. But I'm going to go against the grain this time because I think with the I love the offense. And Seattle, with Russell Wilson, he's not 100%. They're going to be on the road. They, played a tie last week. I'm going to go with the Saints. This week, as my Joker pick, it's going to be the upset pick. This is my pick of the week. Saints over Seattle Seahawks.
Keenan Dunn.
Oh, and guess what we got coming up in 1 minute?
Oh, we got
Noel Jackson with Music Satisfaction.
Keenan?
Upset the Saints.
All right.
That's what I'm saying.
I hope y'all are
right.
That's
my man right there. It's my man right there.
Coach?
That Seattle offensive line is horrible. I'm with you guys. I'm going to pick the Saints here as well.
This must be opposite day. Well, you know, Halloween is on Monday because this is just really strange.
Coons in the house, baby.
We got 60 seconds, folks.
We got 60 seconds. Hey, I just want to give a shout-out to my daughter and to my mother, also to the Ravens. They're doing the barbecue over there today. And I want to thank Keenan for coming in today. And his mother, I never got her name. She's sitting there real quiet. What's your name?
Teresa.
And I want to thank you guys for being here.
And just want to say...
I'd like to thank all the people who was part of that flood in Louisiana. I'd like to wish them, you know, happy wishes. I hope they get what they need. I'm praying for them. And keep your head up. Louisiana, Baton Rouge.
I'd like to thank Milton Mack for joining us. And Mr. Mack, you were part of a lot of very happy childhood memories for me, so it really was a treat talking to you today. And to my wife.
Thank you, man.
My wife and kids, Angela, Erica, Elizabeth, I love you.
Keenan.
Awesome. EDT, J&F, love you.
Y'all have a good afternoon. Noel Jackson coming up on the other side. See you guys next week, same time, same channel.
Protect us from the evil. Hail to the King, Lord of Love. May He protect us from evil.